Welcome back to the rest of the day. After completing first three units, 1, 2, 3, sorry, unit 4, we have started a quick revision of units 1, 2, and 3. Okay, I won't be very elaborate. As far as possible, I will be just recollecting the main theme and certain things related to first three units. This will help you when you just revise the lessons units. The first one is first flight revision, Guillermo Flaherty. Theme of the story, a family of seagull birds has four newly hatched birds, three brothers and one sister. These things, you know, you have to remember. The resting place of the birds was a ledge. It was on the steep side of a tall cliff. See, steep side of a tall cliff. That's enough. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Within 6 words, you know, the location of that ledge, you know, it is pinpointed. And far below was the great expanse of sea. Okay, this is the location. Except the young seagull, his two brothers and one sister had already flown away. They are enjoying nature on the seabed. But the young seagull could not do so for want of courage and confidence. That's important. For want of courage and confidence, the young seagull was not able to join the other siblings. This is the concern of the mother. Okay? The rest of the story reveals how the mother bird takes great efforts in making the bird finally fly successfully. The story begins with the young seagull alone in the ledge, totally disturbed, alone and unhappy. That is the starting mood of the story. Okay? What is the mood? Disturbed, alone, loneliness, unhappiness. Total disturbance, alone, that is loneliness, and unhappiness. That is the state of condition of the young seagull. Okay? Now, how does it end? Finally, we see the whole family on sea enjoying the company of one another. All the four birds, father, mother, all the six are on the sea enjoying the company of one another. That is, the story ends in a happy note. Okay? That should be the justification of a theme of a story, whether it is a story or a poem, whatever it is. That is vocabulary. For synonyms and antonyms, these vocabulary items may help you. Ledge means hole or shelf. Brink means edge. Expanse means area. Flap means spread. Then muster, collect and gather. Plunge, dip, desperately, hopelessly. Devour, swallow quickly. Plateau, flat land is called plate. And then ascending, opposite rising, ascending, rising, opposite descending, blazing, shining, bright, daintily, daintily, delicately or roughly, daintily, delicately and rough, opposite roughly. Scrap, piece, as a noun it is piece, otherwise it is making marks, scrapping pieces. Okay, the young bird, the ledge, scrapping the floor for food. Hump, mound. Preening means cleaning. Precipice means steep side of a cliff. Pretend, act. Swoop, fly. Amusedly, interestingly. Soar, rise. Mock, ridicule or make fun of. Still, motionless. He stood still, motionless. He stood still again. After the instruction, he did not move from there. Still has got two meanings. And then plaintively, sadly. Opposite, cheerfully. Wet means sharpen. Gnaw means biting. Limp, loose. Opposite, stiff and straight. Limping, loose walking. Opposite, stiff and straight walking. That is for synonyms and antonyms, this vocabulary list may help you. And then it's not 10 mark question, only 5 mark question. Make a correction. And then the lone seagull suffering in the ledge. That is one part of the story. That is initial part of the story. Okay. How will you just define, describe the seagull alone suffering there because of hunger? Answer, you have to describe at a time. I have just given you. If you develop it's 4 born at a time, 3 already left the ledge. Of the ledge, you have to describe how it was above, below, how, and the ledge, how was, where was it? Hello. Loneliness and acute hunger, tempting herrings. Herring is a type of fish, and caught and eaten by his siblings. This helplessness of the seagull witnessed by his anxious mother, worried mother. Okay, she was very much worried why the seagull. One seagull is left alone there in the ledge, and who will, and the mother's concern, okay, anxious mother or concerned mother. Mother actually wants the lost bird, the left out bird also to join the rest of children. That is the concern of the mother. This is the first one. And then second part. Play the end of the game. What is the game actually? That bird from the ledge joining the rest of the birds. The sad moment for the lone seagull. Extreme starvation is the motivation and provocation. Okay, motivation and provocation. Apt word to describe the situation. The bird's fear slowly disappears and gains courage. This is well expressed. This is well utilized by the mother bird. Okay, this is well, which is the bird's fear and courage, well utilized by the mother. Is the right time, and the mother rises to act. Displays a piece of fish before the starving seagull, but doesn't hand it over to the bird. Had it handed over to the bird, the bird would not have tried to fly away. Withdraws the fish at the right moment. At the when T is missing there, at the right moment, making the seagull fall in the space. It's falling. It is sudden falling. It's an accident rather. It was not a willing. Okay, instinctive flapping of the wings saves the bird from falling headlong into the sea. So this you have to describe and define as part of your answer for the later part of the story. Explain the end of the game. And then unit 1, that is poem, okay, that is words and phrases explained. It's about the title is Life, and unit 1 poem. Life from year to year, what is the meaning? Not a partial or an incomplete life, but a full life. Okay, life from year to year, it is not partial, it is not incomplete, that is complete. With the forward phase, what is the meaning of forward? Forward actually refers to the position, but here forward contains some extra meaning. That is the imagination, that is the skill of poet. Courage and confidence, the phase that expresses courage and confidence. That is the meaning of forward phase. Similarly, with backward phase means, you know, unwillingness, naturally. Unreluctant soul, reluctant, unreluctant, reluctant, not willing, unreluctant, willing. Unreluctant soul, a mind with willingness. Soul is equated with the mind, you just mind it. Not turning from the goal, no diversion, no deviation, no distraction. I have single aim, I have single goal in my life. Then only I can advance, I can develop, I can reach the summit of success, okay? Nor holding back in fear, no retreat. Once you just start moving, you know, you just move ahead. Don't know coming back, no retreat, no going back. Courage of the quest, journey. Quest means journey. Courage for the complete mission, life journey. Road's last turn. Road's last turn. Here, what is road? Road symbolizes journey. Journey symbolizes life. Road's last turn. Here, turn means events, changes in life. Life is full of ups and downs, okay, joys and sorrows. You have to deal with them, try to enjoy joy, and then try to change sorrow into joy. Life is full of challenges. A road full of twists and turns, okay? The last chance in one's life may bring the best. So, what is the meaning? The last chance, until the last chance, you just wait and see, okay? And one's life may bring the best. Okay, the last chance. Prospero waited for 15 long years he waited there for providing a wonderful future for Miranda, okay? Unit 1, poem life again. Here, two more questions. Two lines will be given, followed by one or two questions. Let me but live my life from year to year with the forward pace and unreluctant soul. Two lines. The question is, whom does the word me refer to? Let me but live my life from year to year. Me, here actually, the spokesperson is the poet. The word me refers to the poet. But actually, does it refer to the poet only? No. Henry Van Dyke may be the poet, that may refer to, but it is applicable to everybody in particular and everyone in general. It applies to everybody. B, what kind of life does the poet want to lead? The poet wants to lead a life of advancement, progress, with willingness, okay? It is with willingness, not only just the progressive life with willingness. You must have some kind of attachment to life, that is full willingness. Number two, not hurrying to, nor turning from the goal, not mourning for the things that disappear. Why do you think the poet is not in a hurry? Not hurrying to, not turning from the goal, not mourning for the things that disappear. Three ideas are there, wonderful ideas. Not mourning for the things that disappear, past. Not hurrying to, not in a hurry, comfortable. Not turning from the goal, one aim, without distraction, he wants to reach the goal. Now, what is it not hurrying to? He's not in a hurry. What does it imply? The poet wants to cherish every moment of his life. There is a beautiful lesson to you, to everyone who is just listening. Wants to cherish every moment of his life. Hence, he is not in a hurry. The poet is not in a hurry. He doesn't want to skip any step in life. Okay? He wants to enjoy life in full. And then the paraphrase questions continue. What should one not mourn for? One should not mourn for the past. One should not worry about the past, sad moments, and spoil the present. When you just think of past events, past sad events, that will spoil your, future, okay? And then three, in the dim past, nor holding back in fear, from what the future wails, but with a whole and happy heart that pays its toll, to youth and age and travels on with the cheer. What does the poet mean by phrase in the dim past? That is, dim means not clear. In the context, the poet means forgettable and distant remote past. Is the poet afraid of future? No, the poet is not a future to him. Thoughts about future should not disturb the present life. That much he is very careful. And how can one travel on with cheer? Forget the past miseries. Don't worry about future events. So the present day, just worry about, concentrate on present. Live the present happily, wholeheartedly from young age to old age. That is a message given by the poet. Okay. So let the way wind up the hill or down, whether going up or down, over rough or smooth, journey will be joy, life will be joyful. Still seeking what I sought when but a boy, new friendship, high adventure and a crown. How is the way of life? Mixture of joys and sorrows, ups and downs, sometimes rough and sometimes smooth. That is the way of life, that is the way of, that is a journey. How should be the journey of life? Despite all challenges, life should be joyful and exciting. Okay, what should what did the poet seek as a boy? As a boy, you know, he wanted friends, he wanted adventure, and he wanted victory. You remember all these three words: friendship, friends. He wanted friends, and he wanted adventure. He didn't like a very dull life. Okay, and then finally victory. And his the life, the journey of life should end up with victory. My heart will keep the courage of the quest and hope the road's last turn will be the best. What kind of quest does the poet seek here? A quest that will fulfill his dreams and desires. Okay, that is success. What is the poet's hope? The poet always hopes for better days and better future. This is positive thought and optimism. So also you try to think tomorrow will be better than today and make it like that. That is positive thought and optimism. Opposite of optimism is pessimism. The dim past, sixth question, in the dim past are holding back, etc. Identify the rhyming words, fear and then cheer and then whole and told. A with the D, okay, and then B with the C, rhyming. Fear and cheer, whole and told. Number 7, let me but live my life, etc. Last words, ear, soul, goal, appear. Identify the rhyme scheme of the given lines. A, B, B, A. Okay? And then answer in about 80 to 100 words. Describe the journey of life as depicted by Henry Van Dyke. That is the essay question. 80 to 100. But you are not going to write any essay question. I mean, paragraph question as far as poem is concerned. Component in questions on page number 27. This is about third, I mean, Prospero. Prospero, that is... The Tempest, you remember, we are passing on to the third piece, that is The Tempest by William Shakespeare. Just comprehension questions, I have not given the synopsis, you know the story. By way of reading out the questions and answers, you will be recalling the theme. Who were the inhabitants of the island? This is Prospero. We have just shifted to Tempest. Sycorax, Caliban, Ariel, and other spirits were the inhabitants of the island till the arrival of Prospero and Miranda. Okay, the island was monopolized by, ruled by Sycorax and Caliban. Ariel was serving as a servant to Sycorax, Caliban, evil spirits. Other spirits were the inhabitants of the island till the arrival of Prospero and Miranda. Once Prospero lands the island, Prospero takes control of the entire island. Okay, what powers did Prospero possess? With his magical powers, Prospero could command the winds and the waves of the sea. That was his power. Also, he could raise a violent storm, causing a ship wreckage. He could punish the evil spirits like Sycorax and Caliban and set free good spirits like Ariel. That is why, you know, he controlled Ariel and he made Ariel serve to his purpose and causing a tempest in the sea bring all the people to the various parts of the island. Number 3, who was Caliban? What was he employed for? Caliban was the son of a witch, Sycorax. He was employed like a slave to fetch wood and do the most laborious offices. Other than that, he was quite useless. He was a substandard human being, not a human being, spirit. Number 4, who were on the ship? How were they related to Prospero? One is Prospero's brother Antonio was there in the ship. The king of Naples, he was also there, a friend of Antonio. who helped him to usurp the kingdom from Prospero and send him away, his son Ferdinand. So Antonio was there, king of Naples was there, and Ferdinand was there, and an old lord Gonzalo, friend of Prospero, were on the ship. Who was Gonzalo? Gonzalo was the one who provided essential things to Prospero when he was left in a boat with Miranda without any provisions for survival. Okay, but for Gonzalo's supplying these essentials, Prospero's life on the island would have become very, very tragic. And then number five, why had Prospero raised the violent storm in the sea? Prospero knew that the ship carried his cruel brother Antonio and the king of Naples. Having waited for 15 long years, who waited? That is Prospero and his daughter Miranda. He thought this would be the right time for the repentance on the part of Antonio and reconciliation on the part of both. So he wanted to bring them to the island by force, by creating a tempest. That is the story. Number six, how did Miranda feel when her father raised the storm to destroy the ship? The young innocent girl, soft-hearted Miranda, tender-hearted Miranda, could not bear with the very idea of a storm. She was not able to bear the idea, the sight, and the crew on board perishing, dying. Hence, she appealed to her father to have pity on their sad distress. What was Ariel ordered to do with the people on the ship? Ariel was instructed strictly, no person the ship should immerse, should sink, shall reserve any hurt. Everybody, nobody should die. Also, he instructed very strictly to Ariel, bring Ferdinand to Miranda. Ferdinand and Miranda should go together. Antonio and the king of Naples will form another group, will be taken to the different part of the island. That was the strict instruction of Ariel, strict instruction of Prospero to Ariel. Number eight, give two reasons why Miranda was so concerned about Ferdinand. Number one, Ferdinand was a handsome prince and quite a contrast to her old, unwholesome father in physical form. He was old, you know, Prospero, and he was a contrast to Ferdinand. Hence, he was an attraction and fascination to young Miranda. Number two, tender-hearted Miranda naturally felt pity for Ferdinand, who was lamenting the loss of his mother. Already, Ferdinand was very much worried. So, as a kind of consolation, the tender-hearted Miranda had pity for him. Number nine, why did Prospero set Ferdinand a severe task to perform? Though Prospero was pleased to see the admiration between Ferdinand and Miranda, he wanted to try Ferdinand's constancy. That is the crucial phrase. That is the answer to the question. Why did Prospero set Ferdinand a severe task? Ferdinand's constancy of love for Miranda was tested by Prospero. So he set a severe task for Ferdinand to perform. He pretended to be very severe and harsh to Ferdinand, but it was only action, pretension only. Number 10, how was Gonzalo helpful to Prospero when he left Milan? Gonzalo privately placed essentials in the port, like water, apparel means dress, provisions, precious books on magic. Without the survival of Prospero and his 3-year-old daughter, that's Miranda, when they entered the island, she was 3. After 15 years, the shipwreck is going on. Therefore, at the time, it was 18, she was 18, Miranda was 18. Would have been impossible. Now, what are the themes of the tempest? That's important. Theme. What is the theme of tempest? Every play by Shakespeare will have a theme. The tempest is a play about magic, betrayal, love, freedom, forgiveness. Okay? Repentance. Repentance also is there. Magic and forgiveness are represented by Prospero. Prospero, the chief character, represents magic and forgiveness. And betrayal is seen in Antonio. And freedom is offered by Prospero and enjoyed by Ariel. So under that condition only Prospero, I mean, when he just enters the island, he gives that assurance to Ariel. When I leave the island, I will set you free. This is another fourth piece. Empowered Women, that is the title, Navigating the World. What does INSV stand for? INSV stands for Indian Naval Ship Vessel. Number two, Then was INSV Tarani commissioned to Indian Navy service on 18th February 2017 to the Indian Navy service. Certain facts and figures you have to remember. 3. Who is Tara Tarani? After whom was the sailboat named? Tara Tarani is the patron deity for sailors. Tara Tarani is a patron deity. It's not an English word. Tara Tarani is a patron deity for sailors and is worshipped for safety and success at sea. The boat was named after the famous Tara Tarani, that is goddess, temple in Ganjam district of Odisha. Okay? Please. Question number four. Where did the crew undergo their basic training? The crew underwent their basic training courses in Mumbai at the Indian Naval Watermanship Training Center and at various schools in the Southern Naval Base in Kochi. How long? They were trained for almost 3 years. Okay. Number six. Which skill was considered important in the selection process? Which are the skills required? Little survival skills. Okay. They are going to travel alone and they will be there for many days together. Therefore, they have to be very good at the survival skills. That is life, we have to live. Okay. That is a skill for life. They are considered important in the selection process. Number seven, who mentored the crew? Okay. Who mentored the crew? Okay, no problem. Number nine, which quality of the skipper helped to bring out a successful expedition? The quality of honesty helped them to bring. This is very important for the entire lesson. Quality of honesty was expected, honest. Everybody who sailed there was honest. And then who among the crewmen mentioned about teamwork? Lieutenant Payal Gupta was the one who mentioned about teamwork. Okay. Number 11, when did they witness the brilliant southern lights from the sea? How did the sky appear there? This is also an important question. When they were crossing the Tasman Sea, they witnessed the brilliant southern lights from the sea. The entire sky was lit up in green light. Wonderful sight it was. Number 12, what festival did they celebrate during their expedition? What festival? You can just remember that Diwali. Glossary, anticipate, foresee, apprehensive, anxious, fearful, auxiliary, additional, bioluminescence, production of light, circumnavigate, to travel all around, consonance, agreement, in consonance with agreement, contention, strenuous effort, expedition, a journey, Golgappas, not necessary, indigenously, naturally or innately or domestically or inherently, morale, self-confidence, nautical, that is distance, measurement, replenishment, restoration of stock or supply, skipper, act as master. It is used as verb, skipper, noun. And then passing on to the next piece, I am every woman, okay? A woman is beauty innate, a symbol of power and strength. She puts her life at stake. She is real, she is not fake. Fake is false, stake is risk, innate is by nature. What is the paraphrase? A woman is beautiful by nature. She is power, she is strength. She is prepared for challenges in life with boldness. She is genuine, bona fide, and not bogus, fake and false. Second stanza, I'll read out the paraphrase only for want of time. For a woman, life is full of roses, even thorns are flowers for an optimistic woman. You have to think like that. You have to take thorns for flowers. Okay? That is optimistic woman. She does not brood about misfortunes and bad times. Winter at times of need. I will rise to the occasion and help the needy. Springs may come and go, but my hopes for better days will never die. Okay? then third stanza, she cannot compromise with her principles. Okay, principle means a principle, philosophy means a philosophy, policy means policy. You should not leave your principles and policies. Persistence is a true attachment to one's commitment. That is strength of mind you should have. Come what may, no deviation, no distraction from the destination. Sighs and groans and moans are all signs of discomfort and distress. Okay, that should not come in your way. Woman is ferocious like a lioness. Do not play tricks and pranks with her. She will never excuse. Do not attempt to torment or afflict or disturb her pride and image. She knows how to freeze, dissolve you and do away with you. So be careful with women. And then supplementary reader, sketch the character of Mulan. Mulan was a brave warrior who saved China from the enemies, you know, determined, courageous, intelligent. She was unselfish too. This incident best attests to the trait. After returning from the war, the emperor offered her the post of royal advisor. She refused because she wanted to have some domestic purpose also. She wanted to serve, help her brother, and not only that, father was there. Mulan's determination helped her through her adventures, defeating the enemy's army. She never gave up in bad situations. At war, she was very intelligent and was quick planner. This attitude won her the war for the Chinese. She fought in the battle for 12 years and gained high merit. She refused any rewards except 6 fine horses and 6 fine swords. That you have to remember, 6 fine horses and 6 fine swords. Do you agree with Mulan's decision to go to war? Justify. Yes, Mulan's decision to go to the war was correct because her father was not in a position to go, and her brother was too small, and also she had been trained in war strategies by her father, and then she was very bold. Because of all these 4 qualities, she was ready to join, and she was patriotic woman also. Okay, I'm not reading, actually I'm telling on my own. Patriotic spirit also promoted her to join the army and serve her nation. Okay, you skip that two columns matching and come to the passage. Many years ago, China, this is answer the question. Yes, many years ago, China was in the middle of Great War. This story once again, it is retold. Therefore, I'll skip it and go to the next slide. That is, passage is gone. Now, questions. What did the emperor say? The emperor said, one man from each Chinese family must join the army. Who was Mulan? As a teenage girl, lived in a faraway village, China. When did she hear the news? Heard the news when she was outside, washing clothes, not necessary. What was her father doing? Father was carving a piece of wood. Where did her father hear the news? He heard it in the town. And then this is another passage. Questions. Who trained Mulan in Kung Fu? Her father. How did she swung the word back and forth with might. Might means a power, force. Did Mulan's father wanted to go to the war? No, did not join. What would the emperor do if he finds she was a woman? If the emperor finds she is a woman, he would kill her. How did she go to join the army? Bade goodbye to her father, climbed on the family horse and went to join the army. And then third passage, you can just you can do it on your own. And the questions are there. How did Mulan prove in the army? Again, questions and answers are there. Just do for yourself. I've given the passage for you. You just read it for yourself. And then Grumble family, name of the family, Grumble family, name of the street, Complaining Street, name of the city, Never or Satisfied, name of the river, Discontent. And no one will feel comfortable in such a family. Growl, cry of tiger, station, position, status, grumble, complain, high, humble, opposite. Paraphrase, these people complain about everything, okay? Nothing is perfect, whether they belong to high class or modest class, uniformly all are complaining nature. They are far from satisfaction. And then here, the folk from Complaining Street are always gloomy and cheerless. You should not be like that. Nothing is right and everything is wrong for them. They are unhappy all the time, even in bright summer as well as in cold winter. Passage number 4, The climax is that even in the midst of perfection and satisfaction, they would complain about absence of complaints. Rhyming words, sun and done, doubt and about. Okay, this also five strangest thing and six grumbling street. You just learn it for yourself. And then some questions again. The last line underline, the smile on your face and a song on your lips shall be your true identity. That's the theme, final theme. You should always keep smiling and song on your lips. That is your identity. No complaint. That is the Grumble family. Questions and answers, paraphrase. You can just read it for yourself. Continues. And then again, walk with a smile, okay? And the song in the lips. Night, the ghost got in. The sequence only. Grover suspected the steps to be mysterious, passed the message to Herman, and he became nervous, rushed to the room, slammed the door. Heavy noise woke up the mother. Mother also shouted. Innocent Bodwells got up and irritated, telephoned the police. Police come, and grandfather mistook the cops, and desert the army attacked them. Number 5-7, finally in the morning, the grandfather very coolly gave tired family information about his visit and dining room in the middle of the night for water. Thank you, all the best. And just take the examination seriously. When you write well, when you prepare well, that will help you for the final examination. Thank you, all the best. Slide